Dear students of class 9A and 9B, today's class is for some explanation of some words which were used by the Mughals during their reign. What are the words? Mansab, Jat, Zagir, Sulhikul. So these are the four words used by the Mughals during their reign. But you have to understand the meanings of these words, otherwise you will be unable to understand the system of administration of the Mughals. First, Mansab. What do you mean by Mansab? What is Mansab? Mansab is, you know, Mansab is a term, means Mansab is a position of rank of the nobles in the Mughal reign. Mansab is a rank of the nobles. Mansab is a rank of the nobles given by the Mughal emperors. This is known as Mansab. And second one, Zat. What is Zat? The numerical value. The numerical value by which the numerical value by which rank and salary of the Mansabdars were calculated or were decided. The numerical value by which the rank and salary of the Mansabdars were decided, this is known as Zat. Zat means the numerical value by which rank and salary of a Mansabdar were decided. The next one, Zagir. What is Zagir? Land granted to a Mansabdar is known as Zagir. Land granted to a Mansabdar for collecting taxes and revenues as his salary is known as Zagir. Zagir means land, granting of land to a Mansabdar for collecting revenue, that would be his salary. This is known as Zagir. And now Sulhikul. Sulhikul, it was a policy of universal peace introduced by Akbar. Since Akbar was a tolerant ruler, Akbar had equal respect for all religions. So Akbar introduced the policy of universal peace, is known as Sulhikul. This Sulhikul, the policy of universal peace, it was promoted by Akbar for religious tolerance, and he wanted to communicate a message to the people of the country during his reign that he had equal respect for all religions and religious concepts and beliefs, and he allowed his wives to practice their own respective religions and as per their own respective religions, and there was no restriction imposed on them because Akbar was a tolerant ruler. Then, only for that reason, Akbar introduced the policy of universal peace, or in short, or in the term of Urdu, Sulhikul. Sulhikul, the policy of universal peace. So, next point, now I am going to discuss other points. Other point that is also important for you, other point that is, during the reign of Akbar, what was the relationship between the Mansabdar and the Zagir? During the reign of Akbar, what was the relationship? What was the relationship between the Mansabdar and Zagir? Relationship between relationship between Mansabdar and Zagir? What was the relationship between Mansabdar and Zagir? Now I am going to explain it. Mansabdars were the nobles. Mansabdars were nobles or the rank holders. They were, paid salaries. Instead, they were given the rank, instead they were given the right to collect revenue from the land granted to them. These lands were called Zagirs, means Mansabdar were the nobles and rank holders. Mansabdars were the nobles or the rank holders, and they were revenue, they were paid salaries, Instead, they were given the right to collect revenue from the land granted to them. These land were called Zagirs. And next one, another point that is very important. Often Mansabdars had to serve outside their Zagirs. Therefore, the revenue from their Zagir was collected by the servants. Many Mansabdars or often Mansabdars had to go outside for any piece of work. But in that case, when they remain outside, the servants on behalf of the Mansabdars, they would collect revenues from the peasants and farmers on behalf of the Mansabdars. So this is the basic difference and relationship between Mansabdar and Zagir. Mansabdar and Zagir. And next point, land revenue and stability of Mughal Empire. Next point, land revenue and stability of Mughal Empire. Okay, these points it is not mentioned in your book, but for your better understanding, I am going to explain it in detailed form. Next point, two important Mughal emperors I am going to discuss about them. They were Jahangir and Shah Jahan. Before discussing about the two eminent rulers of the Mughal dynasty, Jahangir and Shah Jahan, I am going to narrate some points which should be thoroughly explained so that you can understand the administrative systems of the Mughal dynasty. So now, land revenue and the stability of the Mughal Empire. The income from the land revenue helped the Mughal Empire to establish a good economic system in the country. Second point, it was the most important source of income for the Mughals. Money thus collected was invested to the welfare of the state, on buildings, on mosques, on monuments, and on constructing roads and constructing mosques, etc., etc. And next point, it was so important for the proper calculation of land revenue. Todormal, the land revenue minister during the time of Akbar, also assessed land revenue and taxes from the on measuring the lands of the peasants and farmers as per the character, and ensured the huge amount of taxes and revenues, which enabled the Mughals to introduce a good system of administration, which also enabled the Mughals to to frame good policies for the welfare of the people, for the welfare of the country, and they were able to establish a good system of administration throughout the country. People were happy, rich, prosperous, as well as the emperors. And apart another one, Mughal recruited Mansabdar from not only from their own families, but also from Rajput, Sikhs, Marathas, Afghans, Indian Muslims. Why? Because to establish their neutrality, that they were neutral, that they were impartial, that they had impartial attitude towards the people of different categories. In order to prove it, they recruited Mansabdars from different communities, different races, different group of people, and gave them chances to show their skills and talents and originalities, so that they must be patronized by the Mughals. So they must be looked after, they must be granted loans and other facilities by the Mughals. So this is the system, land revenue and stability of Mughal Empire. By this way, the land revenue, the collection of land revenue ensured the stability of the Mughal Empire or Mughal dynasty. Collection and land revenue. Akbar introduced the policy of collection. Before Akbar, it had been the rules for the governors to collect the revenues from their respective provinces to pay themselves and the balance to the emperor at Delhi. But Akbar ordered that all taxes should be paid into the royal treasury. It was the system introduced by Akbar only because of maintaining each and every point of his administration under his own hand. And Akbar wanted to prove that there was a central authority under whose guidelines the entire system of administration would run. That's why Akbar introduced that system. The governors had no right to collect taxes and revenues to pay themselves and the balance to the emperor of Delhi. But through the process of appointing Mansabdars, they would collect during the period of financial crisis. The Mansabdars would collect their taxes and revenues in order to pay themselves. That was the system, and also Zagi. So, next point, now I am going to discuss about the two emperors of the Mughal dynasty, Jahangir. Few parts already I have discussed, and some parts are left. I am going to discuss it. Jahangir. Jahangir and next one, Jahangir and next Shahjahan. These were the two eminent rulers of the Mughal dynasty, Jahangir and Shahjahan. Jahangir, the son of Akbar, ascended the throne after his father's death, and he followed a policy of a piece of justice. He followed the policy of justice. That means Jahangir followed the policy of bail of justice. Jahangir introduced a system of judgment. That judgment is known as Jahangir's bail of justice. Jahangir's bail of justice. That means the emperor had hung a bell from his royal palace, and he also stated that any citizen who felt he was being unfairly treated, they may contact him by ringing the bell, and would come to meet Jahangir for proper judgment. This system introduced by Jahangir is known as Jahangir's bail of justice. And Jahangir, wanted to give responsibility to his favorite son Khurram to go for an expedition for Kandahar, because Kandahar, in my previous class I discussed, but time was not there, that's why I could not explain that point. Now I am going to explain it. Kandahar was a place very useful to the rulers, because it was a place, it was not only a place but a trading route from Asia to Central, from India to Central Asia. That's why Kandahar should have been occupied by the Mughal rulers, but there was none to do it. Akbar made an attempt but failed. Earlier Humayun could not have time, so Humayun could not make any attempt because he remained busy in maintaining his empire, and he recaptured, re-established Mughal empire. So, and afterwards he was no more. So Akbar remained busy in introducing a good system of administration, although Akbar made one attempt, but he had not taken further attempt. If he would take, I think Akbar would be able to establish trading route between Kandahar and India through Central Asia. That's why Akbar was not interested to do it, but after the death of Akbar, that idea came to the mind of Jahangir that his son Khurram would be a suitable hand for that, to be sent to Kandahar for an expedition. But it was due to the wit, it was due to the diplomacy of his wife Nurjahan, Khurram did not want to take any risk, because if he would fail to achieve success, if he would fail to achieve success from Kandahar, Nurjahan would obviously provocate her husband Jahangir against him. That's why Khurram did not want to take any risk. Although Khurram was confident enough to have occupied Kandahar for establishing a trading route between Central Asia and India, but yet he did not want to take any risk, because she knew that some diplomatic policy was there behind Jahangir on the part of Nurjahan, his wife, under whose advice Jahangir always decided. Jahangir always took major decisions. That's why Shah Jahan did not want to go for the expedition of Kandahar, refused. Shah Jahan refused, and Kandahar was lost to the Persians. So this was a great loss to the Mughal emperors, as Kandahar was a major trade route between India and Central Asia. But afterwards, after the death of his father Jahangir, after the death of father Akbar, when Jahangir came to power, Jahangir realized that it was during that period Englishmen who were coming from England for establishing trading relation with the Indians, they should be given some chances. That's why Jahangir gave them chances to start trade with the Indians or Indian subcontinent. The two Englishmen came during the time of Jahangir. They were, John Hawkins and Sir Thomas Rowe. John Hawkins was a physician, doctor, and Sir Thomas Rowe belonged to a zamindar family of England. Both of them came during the reign of Jahangir in order to establish trading relation with our country India. And not only that, they also came as ambassadors of King James I of England, King James I, and sought trading rights and concessions from Jahangir. So they set up a factory. Not only they came to India, but also set up a factory. But before setting up a factory, once there was a rumor that Dr. Hawkins once one once there was an incident, there was an incident happened. One of the sons of Jahangir fell seriously ill, and John Hawkins was a famous physician of England. Jahangir knew it, Jahangir heard it. So Jahangir requested Hawkins to feel the pulse of his son, who had been severely suffering from various diseases. So Dr. John Hawkins felt the pulse of his son, but within few months the son of Jahangir totally cured. He was totally cured of his problems and became physically absolutely fit. So Jahangir became very much satisfied with the treatment of John Hawkins and asked John Hawkins whether he had any demand, whether he had any will. So John Hawkins requested Jahangir to allow them to construct to continue trade in India without having any restriction imposed on them. But at the same time, Jahangir also John Hawkins also requested Jahangir to allow them to construct, to set up a factory at Surat. So under the Jahangir allowed them to set up a factory at Surat. So a factory was set up at Surat in the year 1612. So the English East India Company already had been formed in 1600 AD in England, and the England headquarter of East India Company also gave special concessions to John Hawkins and Sir Thomas Rowe, who was also an ambassador at the court of Jahangir from the court of James I, the King of England, also requested Jahangir to allow them to trade in India without less amount of taxes imposed on them. Jahangir also granted their prayer. So Jahangir was, the another thing is that the marriage life of Jahangir. Jahangir was married to Nur Jahan, the daughter of Idmat-ud-Dawla, a noble at the court of Akbar. Jahangir's wife Nur Jahan was earlier married to a Persian noble, but after the death of Persian noble during the time of expedition done by Jahangir, the husband of Nur Jahan, died, and Nur Jahan became his widow. That very Nur Jahan, Jahangir just saw her, and decided to make her his, queen. The proposal was given, and ultimately she agreed, because Jahangir also very handsome. So Jahangir and Nur Jahan led a marriage life. But Jahangir was, Nur Jahan was not only fairly looked lady, but also very intelligent, and that's why she was able to influence over Jahangir. And Jahangir always, without consulting his wife as Nur Jahan, Jahangir would not take any decision. That's why there was a rumor that the Mughal Empire was being ruled by not Jahangir but by Nur Jahan. He was a person given to pleasure seeking. He was, Jahangir appointed so many officers in his administration from different, categories, different castes, different, communities. He followed the policy of his father Akbar, and afterwards, Jahangir became addicted to wine during his last days, and after his death in the year 1627, Nurjahan retired from the court life only because of Prince Khurram. Already in the meantime ascended the throne of Mughal Empire after his father's death, and Prince Khurram although Nurjahan plotted against Shahjahan when Shahjahan was the prince, but still on being the emperor of the Mughal dynasty, Shahjahan was about to punish her stepmother Nurjahan, but it was due to the effort of Mumtaz Mahal, the niece of Nurjahan. Shahjahan changed his decision and he allowed Nurjahan to lead a simple life, but he also instructed Nurjahan to lead the Mughal court. So Nurjahan retired from the court life and led a very simple life under the care of Shahjahan. And now Shahjahan. Who was Shahjahan? Shahjahan was the, an eminent ruler of the Mughal dynasty. Now time is over. Today is not possible. Next day I shall continue teaching from the points of Shahjahan. I shall discuss in detail about Shahjahan. Thank you.